For this session, we're talking about the best films of 2016, and we hope to compare our lists and hope to hear from you about what you think on the subject as well. And we thought in the extensive pre-planning that went on for this meeting, which is, say, 30 seconds ago when we were talking to each other, that we would just read, each of us would read our list so that we would have all the titles in the air, and then we can come back and talk about them. And when the Seattle Channel shows this, they will have the lists projected, by the way, and they'll all be on the screen. And our Facebook page, I feel certain in saying, will also have the lists by midnight tonight. I'm just going to say that that's a goal. So I will start. Should I start?
Yes.
Sure. Who are you? We'll start.
My name is Robert Horton, and my list is here. And my order is at the top of my list is Aquarius. It's a Brazilian film starring Sonia Braga. Our Little Sister from Japan. The Fitz. Film about high school girls, made by an American independent film director named Anna Rose Holmer. Cemetery of Splendor, a Thai movie from the always interesting filmmaker Abichatpong Weerasethakul. Next movie is Things to Come, film from France with Isabelle Huppert. Everybody Wants Some! ! Latest film by Richard Linklater. Sully, Clint Eastwood directed film about the landing on the Hudson River. Paterson, movie that opened today as we are taping this. Jim Jarmusch's new movie. Green Room, another American independent film. This one by Jeremy Solnier. And finally, a film from Romania called Aferim, also with an exclamation point. So I've got three on my list. Try to top that, Bruce.
Ooh, I have one.
Very good.
So my name is Bruce Reid, and I have this as well. I'm going to rattle off 11 just because I didn't know whether to use this as number one or an honorable mention, because I start off without one, which was a 1970 film by Rivette and Schiffman that had its premiere. It premiered back in the early 70s. It actually had its premiere in 2015. It hit Seattle theaters in 2016. So for me, I counted it as the best cinematic experience of the year. Whenever I do one of these top 10 lists, just so you know, basically the first three or so are pretty much my favorite films, and I know that they belong there. After that, it's like, five could be seven, six could be eight. You know, there's no real order to it. But continuing down from that was Love and Friendship, the Whit Stillman, Jane Austen adaptation. Kosmos, final film, turned out to be by Zalowski. Cemetery of Splendor, already mentioned. Silence, Martin Scorsese's latest masterpiece. Hail Caesar, Coen Brothers' latest masterpiece. Neon Demon, Nicholas Refn's latest anti-masterpiece. The Witch, Midnight Special, Moon Knight, and Elle was the Verhoeven film.
I'm Richard Jameson, Richard T. Jameson, if you have occasion to write it down, but if we're just talking, it's all right. My list starts with Cemetery of Splendor by Joe, as he allows us to reduce his name. Number two is a movie that probably wouldn't have been there a few days ago. It would have definitely been on the list, but it's just been rising in my estimation and affection, and that is Paterson by Jim Jarmusch. Third is the movie that probably gave me the best all-around good time sitting looking at a movie this year, Hell or High Water, a modern Western, or at least a film set in the modern West. Manchester by the Sea, Kenneth Lonergan's family drama, family tragedy, which much of the time is funnier than hell. Sully, an impeccably directed film by, 86-year-old Clint Eastwood, There Is Hope. two films starring Isabelle Huppert and establishing her as the actress of the year, Elle and Things to Come, both out of France, although Elle has a Dutch director, Paul Verhoeven. I think it's the best thing he's done in a long, long time. Number eight is Green Room, which somebody referred to as a horror film. And I say, I don't think it's a horror film, although a few films have been more horrific. Aquarius, Robert's top film, with a magisterial performance by Sonia Braga. And finishing up, Andrea Arnold's latest movie, American Honey, which is a British filmmaker looking at the American experience, which is almost as exotic to us as it is to her, and it filters wonderfully through her camera. Those are my 10.
I've put my films in categories, which I will share with you, although at least one person has suggested they are pretentious.
You are.
Oh, what does that matter? I'm Kathleen Murphy. My first category is sacred and profane. The best film of the year for me was Cemetery of Splendor. I don't even think there's any competition for it. I think it is just one of the best films I've ever seen. Second one in that category is Silence, which I just saw last night, and I just can't stop thinking about it. It is so complex. You might subtitle it The Ambiguities, and it's all about faith and God hunting and identity and a good many of the things that Martin Scorsese has been on about throughout his entire career. Second category is Women in Time, specifically in time. The first film under that that title is Arrival, and the second is Elle, and the third is Things to Come, and the fourth, Aquarius. All films, obviously, with incredible performances by women. And Isabelle Huppert, I have decided, is just not a real person. She can just do anything. She's like Benedict Cumberbatch on the distaff side. She's just capable of any performance you can think of. Sonia Braga is also magnificent in Aquarius. Her hair alone makes her a star. You'll see what I mean when you watch Aquarius. My third category is, of course, one of my favorite categories, Americana. And under that heading, I've put American Honey, which has, I think, one of the most mysterious and lovely American honeys I've ever seen on screen. Young woman who is at the heart of that film. Hell or High Water, which is a sort of modern day Wild Bunch. And Green Room, which is a perhaps perfectly crafted genre film in which heavy metal music stops being abstract or an art or a performance and turns into real life. The fourth category is Manhood, and under that heading, Sully for sure, and Paterson, which is about being a man and being a poet, and Manchester by the Sea, which is one of the most heartbreaking films I've ever seen, about being a man, being a parent, being a husband, and the inability to recover from an experience that I would use the word vastation, which suggests a total wastelanding of a man's soul. Those are my favorite films of the year, and yes, I know there are 12.
I wasn't counting. You could have gotten away with it.
Yeah. We're not bad.
I'm an honest woman.
Should we proceed by talking about why we feel strongly about the films that are near the top of our list?
Well, so I was puzzled by Bruce's list because he started his list without one, and I wondered which one it was.
Which one would it be? Yes.
Without one, yes. That might throw people who are not looking at the title, which is Out One, a film originally released in 1970?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or, well, supposed to have been, never quite, it was done for television.
How long is it?
13 and a half hours.
Okay.
We are now in the age of what's called slow cinema. There are these directors all across the world that are making these massive epics that last for hours and hours. By epics, I mean like, you know, five poor guys sitting around a cheap apartment. You know, guys like Lev Diaz and stuff. And actually, if you look it up, it's still the second, it's considered the second longest theatrically released feature, not counting, you know, sort of art house one-offs like Four Stars by Warhol or something like that. And it is a film, you know, the temptation is to say on something like this, it's like, oh, well, it needs its length to immerse us. It needs its length to engage us. The wonderful thing about this film is it needs its length so that we actually are supposed to sort of drift away from it a lot. You know, it's about these groups of people in Paris. This is post 68. This is post revolution. There are these theatrical groups that are rehearsing these two very different sort of modern for the time stagings of classical plays. And then meanwhile, there is this street hustler, new wave icon, Jean-Pierre Léaud, playing a fake mute who's scouring money. One of the nice things about the movie is that it's one of these things where you find out he's playing a fake mute about an hour and a half into it, which is actually fairly early on, so I'm not giving away a spoiler. but goes up and panhandles and gets involved with this strange conspiracy, possibly. He gets handed this note, which leads him to think that there are these secret organizations. Later you find out that there are secret organizations, but are they doing anything? Are they actually anything more than, you know, the 13? Is it something to concern with? And as all these sort of meanderings happening, all these different divergent characters keep meeting and pairing off and teaming up, not in a sort of rote or mechanical way, not to knock it, of like La Ronde, which is sort of this, you know, mechanistic cycle. It's more of an organic process. And then, like I say, one of the joys of it is that because of its length, you're just free to think through it yourself, so that the film, after 13 and a half hours, it climaxes. I specifically am saying climaxes in isolation. But it doesn't end there. It actually ends with, you know, you think, if you're going to invest 13 and a half hours, your last shot better be something pretty amazing. It's actually not. It's just sort of this enigmatic, what is this image of a character? But that becomes part of it. It's like you suddenly realize, oh, I haven't seen that character for a couple of hours. So what's she going to wind up doing? You know, even after this is all over, you're still allowed to dream and fantasize and engage in the hunt for the snark. It's a remarkable film. It deserves all of its accolades, all of its legendary status, and it was basically unavailable to see. There were samizdat ways of catching it, but it was basically unavailable to see for decades and decades. It was finally made available a few years ago. It premiered in Seattle the very start of 2016, so that's why I considered it the best film of the year for that. Mm-hmm.
And there are other shorter versions,
yes,
too.
Yes, there's a 4.5 hour, 5 hour version called Out One, Spectre, which Rivette himself actually edited down at the time in order to finance it. It's a very different film. It's not as funny. In some ways, that one of the nice things about the length is that you'll be watching these theatrical groups rehearsing, and they're doing these bizarre. No offense if anyone's an actor, but they're doing these bizarre sort of, you know, preparations rituals involving screaming and you know, pawing each other and getting animalistic. And you'll be watching this for 45 minutes, and then it'll cut to like a 1 minute shot of Jean-Pierre Léaud in his apartment house, like stamping his fake thing. Cut back. And, you know, it's just. It's the kind of joke that's funny just because you've been watching something for so long just to get anything else, and then you have to come right back to it. But Rivette's famous for length. This is the one to sort of set the template for that. Most of his films aren't that incredibly long. They're on the long side. But this is definitely the one that sort of established him as the man who can't. There's a marvelous compilation film, I want to say from 95, 96, called Lumiere and Company, where, long story short, a bunch of different directors were given one of the original Lumiere cameras and allowed to film whatever they wanted to. This leads to a reel that's something like, 96 seconds long or so. There's some exact number. So all these filmmakers are making these minute and a half long shorts. And Rivette famously actually ran out of time. He couldn't finish what he wanted to do in the 96 seconds. It was made available on DVD and Blu-ray, I assume. It was made for television. Rivette called it a theatrical experience. I think there is something about being overwhelmed by it in a theater with a group of people, but by any means, in any way you can find it and seek it out, it's definitely worth it.
Available at Scarecrow
right.
Video.
Of course.
Right there in the room, right next door to us. I was thinking about what you said about movies that allow you to drift. I don't know if you use that word, but...
That's what I meant.
you're welcome. I'm always interested in the difference between films that have that kind of breath in them and then films that are just beautifully honed so that everything is in place. And as you were talking, I was thinking that I've got sort of both on my list. A movie like Sully, very classically made, which is impeccably arranged, which is not to say it's linear, because that this film about the landing of on the Hudson, it actually has got a very interesting structure where the things that happen that you expect to see in the movie, like a plane landing on a river, are withheld for a while.
And the film starts after.
After that
incident.
And then not only that, but you then come back to it again for much longer than you would expect, even if they're going to flash back to it again and so on and so on. The Green Room is another one of those beautifully sort of made little gems. But I look at my list and I think in some ways I did this year feel strongly about movies that had a kind of allowed you to drift a little bit in them. Not that they're not very carefully made and so on, but I like that.
Sense Aquarius is like that.
Yeah. Aquarius, for sure.
Things to Come and Cemetery of Splendor.
Cemetery of Splendor.
Different ways.
Yeah.
And everybody wants them.
The ending, certainly, you come to that, and something else will happen after that, but you won't see it. Paterson, maybe a little bit.
Was it a Arrival that you said that you drifted in, but not in a good way?
I did, actually, yes, in my review. Talked about drifting out of that film.
Right, that you needed caffeine to get alerted to it.
I have a sense that someone who put it on her 12 best list is about to call me on that, I'd like to hear.
It's my number 11.
I was going to respond to what you were saying in terms of drifting in a movie and how that, in my mind, connects to the time that exists in a movie, how you feel time. In Things to Come, it seems to me that you're so immersed in the rhythms of everyday life that you're connected to time. Without melodrama, without peak experiences, you are living in a medium. You don't leap out to have a great catastrophe or what have you, even though there are, in fact, what we would call emotional catastrophes in Things to Come, the loss of a mother and the loss of a husband and a son who is a basket case in terms of maturity. There are many things that happen to the heroine, but they aren't experienced as the end of the world, after which there can only be therapy or entering a convent or what have you. She simply goes on living. And in the process of living through many, many moments, you realize that she is in fact growing and saving herself, her life. It's very, very moving. It's in some ways you could watch this movie and say nothing's happening. There are these peak experiences that we witness, but really nothing is happening except the way we experience life, moment by moment by moment. It's another one of those performances by Huppert that is so different from her performance in Elle, a film which is exhilarating in its slap in the face of political correctness in almost every way. In that, Huppert is a fierce, perhaps she's a witch, I'm not sure, but she's fierce in her sense of self. And those of you who have seen it, it begins with a brutal rape witnessed by a totally impassive cat. And afterwards, Huppert gets up, cleans up the glass off the floor, and goes on with her life. And in the process of the film, all of those things that we have come to believe are the way things ought to be, that is, she should have gone shrieking into the night and gotten a therapist immediately, called the police, any number of things. She doesn't do any of those things. She's surrounded by extremely weak and unpleasant men, not least of which her rapist, whom she pretty much takes care of in her own way, often in not very pleasant ways. I don't know, the end of the film is of two women, two old friends walking off into the sunset, which I think is as ironic as anything else in Verhoeven's movie.
Well, ironic, I mean, where are they walking off towards?
They're in a cemetery. It's in Dee Dee. It's a really nasty film, full of acid humor, but as I say, it is exhilarating because it has such a sense of, oh, get over yourselves in terms of political correctness and so on, which we need a lot of these days. But to Arrival, and I will just quickly say this, Arrival fascinates me in terms of a woman being living in a normal temporal universe, we think, and we as well watching a movie in which we think we're living in linear time. Mm-hmm. Begins with a woman grieving the loss of her child, and in the process of the film, finding that we are out of time, we're into some other form of time, as is the heroine eventually. This is a movie in which aliens come to the Earth. The Amy Adams is a linguist who's called in to try to make contact with the aliens through communication, as opposed to bombing them or whatever else the government would like to do with them. Amy Adams is just superb in this film. There's a kind of stillness in her, a kind of opaqueness almost, but a terrific ability to be transparent to these aliens. The aliens are heptapods, seven tentacled creatures, and they are absolutely, they may remind you initially of all those creatures that you saw in horror, not horror movies, science fiction movies in the 50s or something. But they very quickly lose you lose that feeling about them. They become quite noble and interesting and mysterious. And the way they communicate is by drawing these black, inky circles, and then off the circles are limbs and branches and flowers and twigs and so on, so that the circle seems to be growing, and that's their means of communication. And as the movie progresses and she talks to them, more and more she begins to see, think, apprehend the world, think about and apprehend the world in their terms, their sense of time, which is an eternal now. There isn't a beginning, middle, and end. It's an eternal now. The circle, not to get to fall into too much myth, but the circle is an echo of the Ouroboros, the dragon or snake swallowing its own tail, which has always been an image of eternity and infinity. And their drawings of this circle with the offshoots for significance and nuance and so on are evocative of Japanese characters, because in that language you don't have a subject, verb, object, which is also another way of describing linear time. You have a character that you can draw things on, so that you might have a character that means one thing, and then you add something else, it becomes a tree, and so on. So that the image itself is growing before your very eyes, and that's a kind of communication that we don't have. We have to say, tree is growing, and that's happening in linear time as well. And this is what fascinates me about this film. I have not read the novel, and I suspect it's even more complex than the movie.
Not really. I mean, first of all, it's a short story.
Oh, it is?
Yes, and it's very good.
Okay.
I can't remember where you will find it, Jichang. But basically, the movie is actually very, very faithful, except being a movie, they have to throw in a bomb.
Mm-hmm.
So other than that, you get the same story. And it continues the, but it does, literarily, what the film does cinematically,
mm-hmm.
which is that again,
I gathered that
yeah when you're watching this film, and for those who haven't seen it, I'll try to be vague about this. But when you're watching this film, there's this marvelous effect of you being a sophisticated filmgoer who knows what the hell's up, are watching a film saying, and not even consciously thinking this, you just realize what the language you're seeing cinematically is doing. You're just watching this going like, oh, now she's having a flashback. Oh, this is haunting her memories. And that's not what's happening.
Yes, exactly.
And the short story does the same thing in terms of tense and mm-hmm. grammar, where it's, you know.
Well, even when she goes through that weird tunnel,
mm-hmm.
And of course you always have to be a little aware of what tunnels mean in cinema and literature. She goes through a weird tunnel in the alien ship and comes upon a white screen, and behind the screen in this fog are these strange heptapods. But it's on this screen that she learns. She learns the language, and she learns a different way of apprehending, a different epistemology, essentially.
And even that is, because like you say, tunnels, for what they mean, everything like that. It's not just that they go down the tunnel. There's actually, like, in one of the loveliest things I've ever seen in a science fiction film, which is a genre I'm quite fond of, as they go down the tunnel, they actually have to reorient themselves because gravity has been artificially placed. So they're going down the tunnel, and then at a certain point, they all have to actually go 90 degrees and find a new floor.
Yes, that's great, because there's such a sense of disorienting and forcing you into different ways of standing and seeing and communicating. I thought it was just exhilarating. I think it could not have been brought off as successfully as it is if Amy Adams hadn't been at the heart of it.
Yeah, great.
Because it's quite... It's quite ordinary when she's not on the screen, and when there's scientists haggling and government officials plotting and so on. I mean, you've seen that a million times in Aliens Have Come movies. But she makes it mysterious. She makes her own experience is so startling. And when you realize what has happened to her, it's quite radical. There's a moment in the film, I will say, only the exclamation, "Who is this child?" which is the pivotal moment in the film when you realize that you have fallen out of time completely. Now, the fact that women have throughout myth and history been connected with cycles and time, although it's not fashionable these days, nonetheless, they have always been associated with cyclical nature and so on. It makes it even more interesting, I think. And that, too, in a film like Aquarius. Sonia Braga is out of time in so many different ways. She's not living in a time that's conducive to her way of life and belief and feeling. She's out of time because where she lives is coveted by people who want to build condominiums. Surprise, surprise. And that last shot of wood and termites, wow. That's a Bergman image. I think he used it in The Touch, actually. Mm-hmm. But let
didn't
me
have the song playing in Bergman, though.
No, I don't think so. And well, and certainly silence reminds one of Bergman, to say. I mean, they're very aligned, Scorsese and Bergman.
Some of the things that you've said have made me think of time in a different kind of way that it is alive in a particular movie, and I bring this up just because it's a film that we never talked about in one of our sessions here before. The film is American Honey, which Richard mentioned, directed by Andrea Arnold, a director from the UK coming to America, and it's 162 minutes long. It's long.
That's a preferred length for movies apparently this year.
Yeah, there's like three of them that are great that are. And it is a movie that, I know it sounds corny, but I mean, time stopped while I was watching this film. And I really had no idea how long it had been going on, where I was even. And I didn't list it on my 10 best. It's in my next group because I'm still kind of debating with myself about certain things about this movie. But I have never seen a movie quite like this, actually, which I'm not sure that's true of any of the other films on my list. It is a strange film, and it has a rhythm to it, which is about time, that is fascinating, and is seductive, I think, in some ways. And it's about a girl who says she's 18, but there's no verification of that in the film, and she looks like she's 15, maybe. And she escapes an abusive situation because a band of teenagers in a couple of vans sort of see her one day and invite her along, and they sell magazines as they travel around, and one of them is sort of the ringleader. And this really happens, apparently. You can sell subscriptions to magazines by playing on the heartstrings of suckers, and somehow it propels this group of teenagers to keep moving across the country. It sounds like a fairy tale or something, but I guess this actually exists because the director has testified that these kids are out there. But that's what happens, and it's there's no moral judgment of anything that I can tell in the film, and there's this spectacle of these kids making their own way across, and it's just like nothing else. It's a very, very unusual movie, but I have rarely. I'm so glad I watched it on in a theater on a big screen, because there was no distraction, there was no temptation to pause it to do something else. I don't know. It was a remarkable experience for me.
What's another one of those movies, somewhat akin to Things to Come, wherein you approach a number of points where, okay, this is going to be where it breaks. This is where it's going to have to go in another direction. This is the point. She's been driven to such a degree of desperation that
terrible will happen here. Yeah.
And in each case, it's you sort of look over your shoulder and see that receding because the movie
doing something else. Yeah.
And the heroine keep moving.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a true road trip. Yeah. I mean, really, it is. And it's the whole sense of drugging and driving and singing and playing in light that's like honey. It's just exquisite. Yeah, like feral children.
The critics group that I belong to, I gave it my top vote for cinematography because the light in it is amazing. I don't know how much fakery may be taking place in this digital age, but she's just devouring America. Mm. It's light. It's interesting little side roads or streets with crummy homes on them, and everything she looked at was wonderful. Mm-hmm. And it's like she did 500 things I've always wanted to do in a movie, just in terms of looking at somewhere I'm passing through and thinking that would be interesting to put a frame around. Mm.
She also got a terrific performance out of Shia LaBeouf.
Yes,
yeah. He's really good.
Yeah.
And I wish he'd gotten more recognition for his performance.
Completely committed to what he's doing in this film. He's the one recognizable sort of actor that you will know. Some of them seem to be non-actors. I loved the ringleader of this group is played by Riley Keough.
Yes.
And she is just merciless and cold. As I said in my review, has none of the warmth of her grandfather, Elvis Presley. She just completely is in charge of this thing. And Shia LaBeouf, one of the things he does that's amazing in the film is when he's away from her, he's strutting around and he's really cool and he's swinging it.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as she comes on the scene, he literally begins to just shrivel. Yeah. And as he begins to do her bidding and...
Well, he literally goes down to the ground and begins putting lotion on her legs which is really a creepy moment.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, yes. But... in some ways, it was the most interesting film of the year.
Yeah, this is another one of these things where it's like, I couldn't even tell you how come we do 10 movies as opposed to a top 7 or a top. But if we were actually just doing, like, here are the best films I saw this year, if I were going to 15 or, like you were saying, I think, dude, that it was 11 or 12, you know, it's right, it's there. It's just not on the list because you come up with your cut off and, you know.
Yeah.
See what you demand of us?
The expectations of 10. Richard, your top film, Cemetery of Splendor, was it on all four lists?
I guess
it was, So it's clearly something that was well-favored by this group.
Well, how could it not be? It's just in a sublime zone of its own, which is also richly mundane. It's an example, talking about the way we expect films to move or the rhythms we expect them. It's a prime example of that. Well, they live differently over there in the Far East. Mm-hmm. They have a different sense of time. They have a different sense of what is important to foreground or to stop and contemplate or what is perfectly worth contemplating for 10 minutes, even though we may sit there wondering, why are we looking at this? Why is it going on and on and on? But it makes its own very special kind of sense. And not that I think the director thought, I will now make it all make sense. He's observing, he's dreaming and moving at the speed appropriate to what's on his mind and on his soul.
Well, his use of duration, of turning the camera on certain scenes, landscapes, and so on, he lets us look at certain things until they mysteriously transform. For instance, he'll turn the camera on a hole that we've watched being excavated by machinery throughout the whole film. Inexplicably, I mean, no one says they're digging this to make a new building or anything. That machine just keeps digging forever, apparently, because all of history is buried there in his movie. And so this woman is looking at this hole, and there's lots of dust, and some kids are playing in it and so on. And we look at it for a long time, and after a while, you begin to realize that something very strange has happened, something very mysterious. It has completely changed so that the dust seems to be thrown up from history, from the past, from Thai history, from what's buried beneath in this film. And the children have become phantoms of the past. All this without doing anything, no special effects, just making you look at something for a very long time. And he can do this. Do not ask me how he does this, because this is his genius. He can look at a man taking a dump in the jungle, and we sit and watch this man squat and go to the bathroom for a long time. And we think, why? Why am I looking at this man doing this? And then Joe, the director, Joe, his breeze, this strange breeze that goes through the entire film, and which is the air of transformation, begins to move the fronds in the jungle around this man. And in some way or another, this becomes a kind of supernatural moment, a kind of marriage of the most mundane act and something more, something alive in that garden that suggests an imminence. And I'm not talking about God necessarily. I'm talking about something that matters, some transcendental presence, which exists throughout the whole film. He will just show you streets in a certain kind of light, and somehow figures drawn on a fence after a certain time of looking at them come to life. Again, not special effects, just the light and the way he makes you witness what you're seeing on the screen. He is one of the most mysterious filmmakers I have ever seen.
Yeah, you know, because his films, not just this one, but his films are full of ghosts and vampires and all these kind of things, but they're not horror films. They're these sort of, you know, oniric sort of engagements, and you know, nothing much seems to happen. But they do this marvelous jujitsu, and Cemetery of Splendor probably does it as well as anything he's ever done, which is that this is a story that's going to involve, in this case, there's a sleeping sickness that has affected all these soldiers, and in the hospital, which was once a schoolyard and is now being excavated to become something else because nothing can be something forever, the soldiers are claiming when they wake that when they sleep, they're actually being held captive by, you know,
it's the resident psychic who explains
that, that's right, that the a former king is holding them as soldiers for battle.
So and they're fighting an old battle.
An old battle, you know, in their sleep. And there's this sort of sense in which that's like, oh, this would become a horror film. And it doesn't really, because it just kind of meanders on and everything. But as I say, he does this really kind of marvelous jujitsu where at the end of it, it is more horrifying than any horror film you've ever seen. Mm. Because this long engagement with history, you realize, is something that you can't
escape.
Yeah.
Nightmare of history.
It's the ultimate, you know, it's a Bloomsday miracle. And then the as you say, this light, there's this amazing, see, I don't think I've seen anything quite as lovely, where these sleeping soldiers are given these wonderfully ridiculous, I mean, they're out of some sort of like 1960s Japanese, you know, monster movie.
Or Jacques Tati's Playtime.
Exactly. Six of one. Years and years ago, just to take a quick diversion, did you ever see there was, what's his name? Some came running. Glenn Kenny. I was thinking of his time. Years and years ago, Glenn Kenny, who's a critic, posted these images on his website. It was like 10 images. And the joke of it was, and it was actually hard to tell, it was like, are these still shots from Antonioni or Thunderbirds? And it was just a bunch of, you know. But anyways, these sleeping soldiers have these, they're not they're sort of tubes that curve and they're pulsing with light.
Think of this like sort of a straight question mark.
Well, they're like candy canes.
Yeah.
A candy cane.
And as they glow, they, but then that's what happens in this all of a sudden you just cut to the city and you're driving through the city and it's pulsing with that same light.
Mm-hmm.
And you realize, well, I don't know what you realize. I don't know if you realize that everything is a dream, the dream is inhabiting reality, but as you say, it's not the city that you knew. It is now this, you know, it's like that marvelous moment without any actual thing. It's that marvelous moment in every great fantasy where you turn the corner and you go down the alley no one's ever seen before, and you suddenly realize that underneath the city is a world full of magic and mystery and terror and beauty. And that he does this with literally, you know, a pulsing blue light is
and for him, stunning. For this director, there is an eternal now, because all of history lies under current life, current buildings, everything. It's all there, and it may even be sucking the energy out of the lives above ground. And the last shot of that film is shattering, because the lame nurse who has been our every woman through the film, suddenly has a vision of what this might mean, this way of looking at history and the future and so on. And it is so shattering, it's apocalyptic to her. And it's the only close-up in the film, but you have the sense that she sees that it may be that we just live through this stuff over and over and over, and there's no way out. The thing that makes this film so interesting, one of the things that makes this film so interesting to me, is that it's not depressing. Mm-hmm. You would think, the way I'm speaking about it, it would be terribly depressing. It's full of humor. He has the slyest sense of humor. That scene that I described to you about taking the dump in the jungle is both transcendent, but at the same time, he's just laughing his head off. Mm-hmm. Because he's showing us this, and we're sitting there, yes, this is an art film, and in art films, they're allowed to do this, so on. I mean, he's great.
And
he really is.
And he also knows, it's like, you know, when you say he doesn't use special effects or anything like that, he knows exactly how much money he can afford to spend on a film, which is nothing at all. So he realizes there's this fantastic moment, about halfway through the film or so, where the nurse is having lunch in public, and then this woman comes up, sits down, she's like, "Hi, I'm the god that you always pray to." Mm-hmm. And she, oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. No, it's...
But it's just like,
it's,
you know,
two dead princesses.
Two dead princesses, yeah, exactly, that she's been doing the worship. But in other words, the beautiful point is that, like, he probably could have done some kind of filtering effect, something. Nope, he's just like, no. I I'm just going to put the camera here, she's going to walk in, say that, by the way, you know, thanks for your prayers and everything.
Once you do that, it means that anything's possible.
Exactly.
The audience,
exactly.
We're not going to get a filter. We're not going to get something telling us this is.
So she just kind of leans back. The nurse, who is our filter, our vehicle. She just leans back after this announcement is made at the picnic table. There's a beat, and then she goes right back into the chat.
Yeah.
So you're goddesses. Yeah. Here, have a piece of fruit.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, and then so when he does do a special effect, because there is actually a really striking special effect at one point in the film, which I don't have no clue what's going on.
But
with
the sky.
The sky. Yeah. He's able to just say like, "Well, I spent all my money on that."
Richard says it's an amoeba.
Yeah.
Well, you know, when you talk about toilet scenes, it obviously makes me think of Jane Austen.
Of course.
And I would
absolutely
segue to the Bruce, the film that is toward the top of your list, although right after a 47-year-old movie, is Love and Friendship, which is Whit Stillman's adaptation of Jane Austen, and a film that is not at all loose or funky in any way, but is a very tightly
very
carefully made film.
Very composed. But first off, if you haven't seen it, the joy of Love and Friendship is after so many Austen adaptations, after so many period adaptations, that understand that they're comedies, but are, you know, still making sure everything is decorous, everything
reverent.
Reverent. This is just hilarious. This is just a film that knows there's nothing funnier than a man looking ridiculous because he's an idiot. You know.
The heart has its strength.
I don't think we need to make this personal.
Stillman has, for years, been, he's a director that sometimes gets dinged for not being visual. I think he's a very smart visual director. He's not a flashy one at all, but he places the camera to capture jokes better than anyone has since Blake Edwards for or something. But the one thing I will point out about Love and Friendship, now I never do this. One of my great, great deficiencies as a critic is I cannot generalize from a film. I can never look at a film and say, here's what it's like to be in the waning days of the Obama administration. Or, this film, which, was started 5 years ago, based on a book 10 years ago, and was finally finished 2 years ago, is perfectly capturing the dynamic of this moment right now. But I will say, I will break my own convention and say, of all of these people that are out there trying to find like the film to encapsulate the Trumpian world we are now in, and they're latching on to desperation, they're latching on to apocalypse, they're latching on to things. This is a film in which a woman, wonderfully played by Kate Beckinsale, is in any other film, she is a monster, she is a savage scavenger. The whole point of this film is, because of class and because of sexism, she has to be, and good for her. And it's just saluting her the whole way. And it's like, damn it, if we're going to say, like, oh, this is what we live now, this is the world we live now with Trump, take this one. Take this one and say, that I'm right. I'm just going to punch back. I'm going to take what's mine, and if you try to call me out on it, I'm going to say, what other choice have I got? Because her relatives are constantly trying to do the refined, but dear, is that like actually proper? That you should? She's like, well, it's not exactly as though I have your money. And that's a paraphrase, but that is the actual exchange.
Because propriety costs money.
Exactly, yeah. And this is a film that understands money, it understands sexism, and more than that, it understands that nothing is better than a really well-timed joke. So I thought.
But don't you think? Or do you think that Kate Beckinsale's character, Lady Suzanne, don't you think that she has some distant relationship to the woman in Elle, Michelle?
Just in terms of that transgression of any kind of societal.
No, I think she's got a fierceness in her that is, to some extent, just plain amoral.
Yeah.
Not just caused by external forces, but met with a kind of a kind of amorality that doesn't have anything to do with time or place.
No, there's definitely that to it, but I do think that there's like for Lady Susan, there's a pragmatism to it that. In Elle, one of the joys of Elle, which is this marvelous film, but one of the joys of Elle is that you are watching a character that's making decisions that you yourself sometimes are like, what the hell are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, like I say, the great thing with Lady Susan is just once you just dive over into the nefarious pool of anything goes to get ahead, you understand exactly what she's doing every step of the way. Even her manipulation, she just doesn't want her daughter to marry poorly.
Mm-hmm.
Because if her daughter married poorly, she herself would not get more money. Mm-hmm. So that can't happen. So what
would be... Yeah, but if her daughter is in competition with her, she will take the guy.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
Whether or not the daughter marries poorly.
Well, again, pragmatism. You've got to have 3 or 4 balls in play at all times.
Terrible pun.
But it's marvelous. But and it's funny because Stillman had a reputation. I don't know. Wood Stillman had a cult among a lot of right wing film fans. They thought, here's finally a conservative filmmaker. And they only thought this because he tended to follow conservative characters. Yeah, and everything. He himself has always claimed it's not at all. He actually calls himself a Fabian, which. Actually, you kind of have to be a crackpot conservative to call yourself a Fabian, I suppose. But that, you know, the notion that you can pigeonhole someone's politics based on the characters that they are following, mm-hmm. or the topics that interest them is just blown out of the water in a really lovely way by him. And this is probably his most explicit. It's not his only example. He famously, for a guy who conservatives loves, he was famously derailed for years and years. People were like, oh, what's Stillman? What's he been doing? For like a decade or something, he was trying to adapt Russell Banks' novel, Continental Drift. And it just never happened. But trust me, if you've never read it, you say, I can't imagine a conservative coming within 50 pages of starting this Russell Banks novel and not tossing it across the room.
Horton, you wrote, I thought, we agreed, one of the really best reviews of Paterson. And I say something about Paterson. It's on your list.
It is on my list, yes. Well, thank you. Paterson is a film by Jim Jarmusch, who keeps getting better. Someone whose career has been going for 30 years now, and seems to be coming more and more into his own. And I think it's just a wonderful movie that is about a man who lives according to the rituals of the day, which he has to be on his rituals for a couple of different reasons. One is that he's a bus driver in Paterson, New Jersey, and the other is that he's a poet in Paterson, New Jersey. And these both require discipline, and they require time set aside for practicing what you're doing. And I love that idea of having those two things happening in this guy's life at the same time. And I feel like Jarmusch has always been good at whimsical things. His films are often very funny, going all the way back to Stranger Than Paradise. But there's some sort of discontent beneath this film that makes it not just fly away on, oh, that's another really cute scene that's well designed and all that.
What kind of discontent did you feel?
The kind of discontent that would explain why the guy needs to go get a beer every night instead of be with his wife at home, which he apparently does. He goes to walk his dog, and then he parks the dog outside the bar, and he sits for what looks like a beer. But he seems to need this. It's another part of his ritual to get out of the house of his slightly kooky wife.
But she's all about disorder. Disorder and creativity of a different kind.
Yes.
And I love the way he has them wake up every morning, sort of nested together. It does that every morning.
Yeah.
And, you know, I guess it's part of the ritual, do you think? Of his life.
The film is arranged around the same kind of ritual, so yeah. That's Jarmusch's discipline too, is to make us understand that this movie will keep coming back to mm-hmm. these moments, so that we can see.
But did you feel that he was having a beer every night because he was discontented, or
why is he having a beer every night?
Well, because it's nice to go to a bar and have a beer with, particularly a bartender, is that much fun to talk to.
Yeah, I agree, but...
And who can talk about all the heroes that grew up in Paterson.
Yes, Lou Costello
among
them.
I'm not disagreeing, I'm not seeing it. I thought that was just a balance, you know. Mm-hmm. Here's the kooky wife, and he spends time with her, and a hideous dog, and... Then he goes out for a beer, so there's separation and another environment, and it's as much a ritual as saying hello to the guy he works for.
Okay.
When he gets
well,
to
then
work.
Why does a guy have rituals? Is there not some sort of discontent that underlies
there.
The need for that kind of order?
Yes, that's the thing that I hoped you were going to get at, the sense of patterning. Paterson, in his life. He seems to really thrive on patterns, and then what happens is that the dog blows them up by eating his patterns, his poems. Mm. And maybe that's for the good, do you think?
I think it's a happy ending, yeah.
No, but I mean, if you get too comfortable in your rhymes yeah. and
no,
patterns.
I think the film is for that. The film I think has a. This is a guy who won't. He's got his poems in his notebook, and he won't copy them down. He won't put them on a computer. Something is holding him back from that. And maybe that raft of poems need to get chewed up by the dog, so mm-hmm. he can go on to the next.
Or maybe he just needs to let go.
Mm-hmm.
Because he does seem pretty buttoned down in some ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think you're right. There is some kind of something uneasy in all of that lovely fluidity and everyday experience. But I'm still teasing out what I was feeling about
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm.
You should talk about silence. Because I think you really immediately cottoned on to... what made it a great film?
I don't even have it on my list. Although that's,
that's all right. You can still understand it.
That's partly because, whoa, I saw it and say, okay, I'm going to live with this for a while. And so it's an also-ran at the moment. But who knows? It may creep up.
But still.
I don't know. I
always feel a little odd about this because for one reason or another, I have never been a Scorsese idolater, and I don't really embrace the idea that he's our greatest filmmaker. I think some of the movies he made have been pretty terrific, and some of them I have little use for. This film has probably met with more resistance, or at least. At best, non-committal responses from people, I gather, than most of his films. And yet I came away from it feeling a greater degree of respect and a sense of its value than I have with his other recent films. I'm not sure whether it is. We had a conversation about it, and I don't know which point you're thinking of when you asked me to talk about it, but... It seems to me that it gets at so many different gradations of the ways that it is possible to feel about and act upon faith in God, faith in one's mission as a believer, and the characters, the central characters in the movie are Catholic priests in Japan in the 17th century.
Mm-hmm. 1543, I think. No, I'm sorry, 1643.
Yeah, they call that the 17th century.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
No, I was thinking of the Inquisition, which comes to mind.
Yeah, that was another part of the conversation we had. Because it's a time of extreme intolerance on the part of the Japanese authorities, what do we say, the Buddhist establishment, and that they're making outright war on the Christian faith and people who hold it, and at the same time that on the other side of the world Christians are making war on unacceptable faiths that must be driven out of Europe, though that's not articulated in the movie, but it's part of what we had in mind in our conversation. Anyway, increasingly as the film proceeds, it's like how much is keeping the faith an act of endangerment for a lot of innocent people around you, who because you're there and keeping the faith and inspiring them to keep the faith, you've made all of them enemies of the government and at the prey of this quite heartless. Although by no means uncivilized repression. There's a character in the film who is called the Inquisitor, and it's a terrific character, but I think probably even better because of the performance by Issei Ogata. And as I was saying to Kathleen last night, about halfway through, I said, so my God, he is the reincarnation. he is channeling George Arliss, because visually and in his voice and in this strange little manneristic whimsicality, he's evoking this actor that maybe some of you have never heard of, but he's from the transitional period between silence and sound, and he ruled a certain kingdom for a few years. He always had to be billed as Mr. George Arliss. And somehow there he was in the form of this Japanese character.
These two young Jesuit priests, the Jesuits being among the proudest of the Catholic priests in their intellectual ability as well as in their faith. These two young priests go to Japan. It's their mission to save souls. Never occurs to them that they are going to someone's country, that they are invading someone's culture, that Japan might have traditions of its own. Oh no, they are arrogant in their religious pride, their spiritual pride, and they're sweet and good and kind. And they get there and they move through this fog. It's almost as though they're going to some dark night of the soul where their faith is going to be grievously tested, which it is. And so these poor peasants, I mean, who are living the most subsistent level of existence you can imagine, are delighted that they've returned. Padre, we're glad you returned, even though hundreds and thousands of them have been executed. But these people are so happy that the Christians have returned to give them little pieces of bread, the host, and whatever they're using for the blood of Christ, and to give them the great story of the Son of God. There is no sun in this world where they live. It's all gray and foggy. So that all of the abstractions and symbols of Christianity, you can see that these people need the reality. They need food, not little pieces of bread. They need sunlight, not a Son of God who is crucified for them. And the irony is, of course, that the Japanese officials have started crucifying the Christians. They learned that from Christianity as a form of execution. But there's this, you watch these two at the beginning of the film, and from our kind of cynical post, you know, God is dead positions and so on, we think, well, they're so silly. Can't they see that these people don't really even understand what they're saying? What they're buying, like medieval serfs did, is paradise. Sure, we'll die for this religion because anything's better than our lives. And they keep saying paraiso, paraiso, because they're going to go to heaven. And
well, actually, it, going back to what's been your theme of the evening, no, honestly, because if you remember, one of the really fascinating little things is for the peasants, they don't think of paradise as the destination. They're constantly saying to the priest, it's like, oh, so we're in paradise now. Yeah. And the priest is like, no, it's
later.
Later. And you can tell there's this whole exchange where he's explaining this to, it's, I think, as you mentioned, it is a funny film. Or actually, that was a different one. But one of the things about silence is that in Scorsese quality, it is a funny film here and there. And one of them is this exchange where these people are taking a baptism, and they say that so the child's in paradise, and he's like, no, it's a reward. And then they just sort of nod and leave away, and you realize neither side has understood
anything
mm-hmm. of the other. But that doesn't matter. There's this marvelous exchange that it becomes the crucial part at the end, where this is all, you know, Christianity is covert and you can't have anything. And one of the Japanese peasants gives to a priest, I believe it's supposed to be a crucifix, literally, that there's supposed to be a body of Christ mm-hmm, on it, mm-hmm. that he has carved out of wood. This is the most crude. This is not a lovely work of art. This is something that was hacked away by an untalented man.
It looks like a night. Dark Ages kind of carving.
Yeah. But it becomes, you know, this incredibly, when you talk about, you know, light and magic and mystery, you know, there are these shots constantly of these wafers and stuff, of these hands going back and forth. And these are muddy workers' hands. These mm-hmm. are calloused and torn, nailed, and unattractive hands that are cradling these hosts and these crosses. And at one point he gives away, the priest has nothing more to give them, so he takes apart his rosary and he's giving away a bead to each one because they want actually a physical embodiment. And that even becomes part of the thing. Is that kind of fetishism good? Is it a bad thing? The film doesn't know. The film has the courage to understand. I think the film is unambiguous in its ultimate embrace of the importance of faith, but it doesn't pretend to understand the workings of it or the mechanisms of it or the answers to it.
Yeah. Even in the film, I don't think we know what faith is. Mm-hmm. It exists, clearly, but what is it? Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you why I ask that. And I'm going to go a little bit afield here, because Scorsese has always fascinated me in terms of this particular theme. His Last Temptation of Christ, I think, is just one of the best films about faith. Christianity ever made. But in all of his films, Scorsese's characters want to be somebody. And the whole business of being somebody, having an identity, standing out, can be a matter of, oh my God, I've just had an identity thrust on me and I don't want it. That is in The Last Temptation of Christ. Defoe wants to offload his identity as Christ. Several times he tries to offload it. And Scorsese tends to have these overhead shots of men in some prone position, and he looks down on them in their crisis of identity. There's one in Silence, there's one in The Last Temptation of Christ. Or one's identity is up for grabs. You're not quite sure who you are. Say in The Departed, you might be a good guy or a bad guy. You're playing roles. But in most of his films, there is a sense of wanting to be somebody. If you remember in Goodfellas, there is one of the most exhilarating camera movements when Henry Hill, Ray Liotta, mm-hmm. Goes into a nightclub. And this is a guy who's aspired to be a made man from his childhood. And now he is somebody, and he goes into a nightclub with his girl, Lorraine Bracco, and the camera just, it is just the most exhilarating movement through the nightclub, because everybody is saying hello and shaking hands and looking up to him, and he is full of himself, his identity. It's the peak experience of his life. He thinks he knows who he is. And so Scorsese has always been interested in this sense of how we find a way to think of ourselves as somebody important, or at least somebody. And one of the ways we do that, obviously, is to have faith in God. Because God, our religious faith, confers identity on us. It tells us who we are and what we ought to do and where we're going. In other words, if we have faith in God, we can be a good fella. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you get the pun I'm making, because there's nothing more that Andrew Garfield, the primary priest in Silence, nothing more he wants except to be a good fella in the community of saints. And it's exactly that he can't quite figure out how to get. And the thing is, Scorsese is so smart, so honest, that he also knows that when we're reaching for identity, when we're reaching for a sense of self like that, and we're trying to find it through God, there is a real narcissistic aspect to that. All through the film, Andrew Garfield keeps flashing on a picture of Christ. He wants to be Christ in his crises, as he's tempted over and over and over again, as Christ was in the desert. There's a moment when he's washing his face in a stream, and he looks down and he sees the face of Christ. So that our desire to be a good fella, a saint, somebody, is not only an impulse towards being good, being more than just a human being, but there's also vanity involved, narcissism involved, and Scorsese will not make it easy for us or for the young priest, because there's no doubt that he gets off on being somebody, in a very special saint or martyr in this film.
There's a marvelous exchange at a certain point. I'm blanking on the word now. It'd be the opposite of proselytize. We're basically, they're leaving, the priests are about to split up, and the local farmer asks him, it's like, well, what if they ask us to profane?
Apostasize.
Yeah. That's right. There's this marvelous moment where Garfield, who is, again, trying to be there, insists, he's like, you should apostasize. But he does so, it's advice I think the film does say is wise, but he's doing it in such a kind of showy manner.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's not just saying, like, apostatize, do what's right, save yourself. He's literally, it's his De Niro moment in the movie.
Yeah.
Apostatize. Uh-huh. And Adam Driver, the other priest, immediately calls him out and says, like, no, you can't do this.
Image of hands, by the way, sharing that crucifix, and other images of those dirty, crusted hands and so on, they're matched by, over and over again, Scorsese's fixation on the means of apostatizing. The Japanese make people, individuals, put their naked foot on a plaque which shows Christ or the Madonna or some religious image, so that they are putting their foot, that is showing the greatest disrespect for the icon, Christian icon. And the contrast between those cradled hands and those filthy feet of people trying to stay alive, because you can't believe the things that are done to these Christians, to torture them and the horrible ways they're executed. And that, for those of you who are Bresson fans, that image of the foot on the religious plaque is pure Bresson, that sense of the lowest part of ourselves, the most mundane part of ourselves, most pedestrian part of ourselves, on the thing that raises us, that elevates us, the religious icon that elevates us, that terrible contrast, that wrenching contrast, is pure Bresson, and it's pure Scorsese as well.
I want to make a
dirty jokes,
please.
Don't you want to know why none of us had La La Land?
No, we're pretty sure why.
We're good with that.
Well, I don't know why the other three of you don't have La La Land, actually.
Are you seriously asking?
Yes.
my thing with. I enjoyed La La Land. I think he's a talented guy. He has this weird inability to care about anything beyond his protagonists, so that, you know, while you're watching this musical, all these other characters, other than our main two, and then briefly John Legend, just sort of like hover in the background, out of focus. They're never really anybody.
It's one of the things that bothered me about the movie is if this guy likes old musicals, where are all those great characters who occupy the second and third?
Just watching the credits at the end, Rosemary DeWitt. I like Rosemary DeWitt.
That's right. She was in that one scene.
Yeah, exactly. fact, it's even like his big motif in the film. He does it like three or four times. It's a nice effect, whatever, is to actually drop the lights down on everything except a spotlight on the main character, whoever the main person is at the time. And at a certain point, you realize it's like, oh, other directors would use that as a heightening effect once or twice. That's his whole worldview. Mm. That's his whole philosophy. It's like nothing else matters except this one person. Mm. And which is doubly ironic and unfortunate because I actually really love, if nobody's seen it, I actually love the opening number because it seemed to promise it wouldn't. I had the same problem with his previous films. And I thought from the opening number, oh, I wouldn't have that problem this time because it does follow all these different people doing different
things. Community
of
people.
I liked it better at the beginning of the Golden Globes.
With, yes. The Jimmy Fallon version.
I think it's a nice movie. I certainly would not try to persuade anybody they shouldn't go to see it. I think it's ridiculous that it's the runaway favorite to win the Oscar and everything. And I will say that I wouldn't like the film nearly as much as I do if it were not for the existence of Emma Stone. I think she is so alive in every second that she's there.
Is that a critical observation?
It is partly a critical observation, but it is a response to a phenomenon of movies. Somebody who is constantly watchable, alive, engaged, even if much of the time it's trivial stuff. That's movie vitality. And she gives this movie, I think, it's real vitality.
Mm. And I don't think Ryan Gosling has that kind of vitality. He just sort of wimps out. There's nobody there, which is odd, because when he's in something like Only God Forgives or, what is it, Driver?
Drive.
He's very still. And it's as though he becomes more visible and more solid, the more still he is. Mm. Whereas in this movie, he's supposed to move and he becomes less visible, lighter somehow, and doesn't hold up.
Did you see him in The Nice Guys?
Yes.
Because I love his channeling of Lou Costello. I wanted to mention Lou Costello again.
Yeah. No, I thought he was a
very
delight
funny,
in that.
Very funny performance in the film.
Yeah.
Is there any other sort of summing up that you think of the year?
Well, see, again, this is where I always break down.
You're on record as not believing that these movies represent anything about the times in which we live.
Exactly. Here's how Silence, which Martin Scorsese wanted to make 26 years ago, speaks completely to right now. You know,
I haven't seen the film, so I can't say that. But there is sometimes a reason that movies get made after 20 years.
And sometimes movies just speak all on their own. Mm-hmm. It seems to me Casablanca did that to some extent. They just speak. They have a voice. Mm-hmm. And it's sort of a magical thing that movies can generate. But, yeah, I think a film like Silence... I think it's come at a very interesting time when you try to think about silence and the world we're living in just now. I think it's important for people to see it and not be silent.
Why aren't there more big blockbusters on any of these lists? What is it? Does this mean that movie critics are fatally out of touch? Which is something that you see on Twitter every week?
Yes.
Yes, it does. Yes.
And
as Billy Wilder said in the 70s, who would want to be in touch with these times?
But it is nice to see all these women, these female-oriented films. I mean, I hate that ordering up a quota that so much of commentary about women in the movies seems to be on about. But I am glad to see these performances. They're superb. Mm-hmm.
By strong I don't mean like that. I mean complex and difficult movies about women, mm-hmm. and some of them by women as well.
Yeah, you know. I mean, sort of roles that are strong and interesting as the roles women had in, say, the 30s and 40s.
Yeah, there was.
I was curious about the movie Neon Demon. Like,
you
all thought of it.
Yeah.
I liked it very much.
We did talk about it in a show that you could find on seattlechannel.org.
In which I defended it against a great deal of male ignorance.
Well, I don't know if it really went down like that. Some of us were quite sympathetic to the film.
Unfortunately, we're out of time.
But yeah,
it's a really good film, and Bruce has it on his 10. Mm-hmm. I noticed.
I thought it was great. I think Refn is just this wonderful. There are plenty of people that come off as provocateurs. I think Refn is actually the real deal, in terms of a guy who just follows his vision to the. But there's what you want to check out. You do want to go to SeattleChannel.org because. Kathleen does a marvelous interpretation of it as a ritualistic and, again, I don't want to use the word feminist per se, but as a
more mythic
and exploration of the woman's role and everything.
He likes Greek drama and myth. Only God Forgives is an interesting exploration of Greek mythology and devouring mothers and so on. And Neon Demon is chock full of goddess worship and women close to cycles of time and so on within fashion, the fashion industry. I think it's a challenging film and really fun to talk about mm-hmm. and to see.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I do like those movies that even while you're sitting there watching it and not entirely sure I'm not sure how I feel about this, or I'm not even sure what's going on, but you still have that sense of nobody else would make this movie other than Nicholas.
But isn't that a wonderful feeling, though?
Yes, it is.
Know what's going on exactly and to feel like, oh, my God, this is surprising me. Mm-hmm. For me, there's nothing more awful than sitting in a movie and knowing exactly what's going to happen next. Yeah.
Well, I've mentioned before that the worst feeling for me actually is a variation on that, which is, and this when you see too many movies, you'll watch a movie, you can predict what happens next, and what happens next as you're predicting it is the most ridiculous thing ever. Yes. Like, you realize that the stupidest thing in the world right now is going to be the fact that she's going to turn out to be his long-lost sister. And sure enough, like two scenes later,
Well, that's a lot of passion. The thing that bothers me is that the next moment comes and you're still bored.
Yeah, oh yeah.
You know, I mean, you can't even go, oh.
Yeah. I used to, honestly, like with modern, one of the things about modern theaters, now that they all have the hidden mic, you know, the hidden speakers and everything is embedded in the floor, I used to actually, the way I would zone out was I would like look at the speakers. Just because they were illuminated in the light, and it would just be like a box that was sort of flickering, mm-hmm. and be like, okay, at least I can watch this.
Wow.
This is more interesting than what's going on.
That
up
is
there.
Quite a statement, yes. One step up from watching paint dry.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Well, we can certainly continue this talk informally, but I think we're going to draw it to a close formally. Mm-hmm. And as I said, our lists, we'll put them up on the Facebook page of Framing Pictures. And they will also be on the screen when this shows on the Seattle Channel. But thank you very much for coming this evening. Appreciate your attendance.
Absolutely.
Yes, thank you.